families into able hands, Lord Jesus, today. Every situation that we are in right now, whether good or bad, God, we surrender it all to you, O God. We give our lives to you. We set our hearts on you, Lord Jesus, this morning. You're worthy. Lord, you deserve all the honor and praises, O God. Make us what you want us to be, O God. We humble ourselves before you, Lord Jesus. Wherever you are, just trust in the Lord Jesus. Surrender your heart to him right now.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Lyston Church's Bible study this Thursday afternoon. And we thank God who has given us this opportunity to be here and who has made us the light of the world. The Bible says that we are the light of the world. Therefore, we are here to bring light to this generation, this dark generation that we live in. We are here to shed the light of Jesus Christ. And if you are watching us and if you joined us today, I would like to urge you to share the service. We are going to have a time of just looking into the Word of God. If you are there, just share the word, the service, or like it, comment. We invite you to comment and just tell us what the Lord is doing in your life and what you are getting from this Bible study today. We've been looking at the book of Acts. I think from the beginning of the year or so, and we've been systematically studying the Word of God. And today we reach Acts chapter 13. Last week we did Acts chapter 13, the first part of it, and we just managed to do three verses. And I think it was important for us to look at those three verses in regard to what we are doing and in regard to ministry today. And today we want to look from verse 4 up to the end of it. I'll not read the whole of it because it will take time. But I'll just read a few verses as we go and as we study it as we go. Therefore, let's begin reading from verse 4, Acts chapter 13 from verse 4. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, remember verse 3, verse 1 and to 3, the Holy Spirit told them, instructed them to set aside Paul and Barnabas for the work that he had separated them for. And verse 4, it begins by saying that so being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus. And when they arrived in Salamis, they preached the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews. They also had John as their assistant. Remember those words. They also had John, who was also called Mark, as their assistant. Now when they had gone through the island of Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew whose name was Bar-Jesus, and who was with the proconsul Sergius Paulus, an intelligent man. This man called for Barnabas and Saul. This man, the ruler, this guy called for Barnabas and Saul and sought to hear the word of God. But Elymas, the sorcerer, that guy, but Jesus, for so his name is translated, withstood them, seeking to turn the proconsul away from the faith. Then Saul, who also is called Paul, remember now that the name of Paul is being changed. He's changing from Saul to Paul. Paul was initially his name before the faith, his name, before joining the Jewish council, his name was Paul. But when he became a Jew, he became Saul. Therefore, when he becomes a Christian, when he enters the faith, he realizes that even the Gentiles can get saved. Therefore, he reverts back to his Gentile name, which was Paul. Then Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at him and said, "O full of all deceit and all fraud, you son of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness, will you not cease perverting the straight way of the Lord? And now, indeed, the hand of the Lord is upon you, and you shall be blind now, seeing the sun for a time, and immediately a dark mist fell on him, and he went around seeking someone to lead him by the hand." Verse 12, then the proconsul believed when he saw what had been done, being astonished at the teaching of the word. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the reading of the word. I pray that, Lord, may you direct us and teach us in regards to your word, O God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Somebody say amen. It's important for us to know that every time God wants to do something, he starts it by sending forth a word. Every time God wants to do something new, something unique, he sends forth a word. He sent forth a word to a man. The Bible says that these guys were in a place of fellowship. They were in a place of fellowship. They were ministering to the Holy Spirit. They were fasting and praying. Then God sends a word through the Spirit and says that separate for me Paul and Barnabas for the work that I have for them. Therefore, the word of God goes forth to these guys. The word of God goes forth to Paul and Barnabas. And the Bible says that immediately they set forth to do what the Lord has said. Hallelujah. Every time God wants to do something, again, I say that he sends, the first thing he does is that he sends a word. The words that God sends to you are not just suggestions. They are not things that God is saying to make you feel good. They are things that God intends to do in your life. It might be a prophetic word, but every prophetic word is God is showing you his intent in the near future. Prophecies are just statements of God's intent in the lives of a human being. Therefore, when God tells you what he intends to do, it is an invitation for you to partner or to join in with him in doing what he intends to do concerning that situation, concerning that word. Therefore, when God sends a word, the only thing, the only response that will glorify God is when we begin to act on what God has said. The only response that gives glory to God is when we begin to act on what God has said. Because the right son, the son that gives the father the glory, is the son that does what the father has said. Therefore, when God sends this word to Paul and Barnabas, verse 4 says that they set. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Cilicia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus and went and arrived in Salamis and preached. They preached the word of God in the synagogues. Hallelujah. When God sends you a word, your response has to be action towards what God has said. Your response to the word of God is not to be excited about it. Your response to the word of God is not to be emotional about it. God does not require emotion from you in response to what he has said. God requires action. God requires you to act on what God has said. Therefore, when God gives you a word of prophecy, when God gives you a statement of intent in your life, he does not want you just to stay there and to move around the word that he has said. He expects you to begin to walk. He expects you to begin to work. When God sends a word, you cannot stand there stagnant, because the action that you apply on what God has said is an indication of faith. The Bible says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Therefore, when you hear the word of God, it develops faith in you. It develops faith in you. What is faith? Hebrews chapter 1 says that faith is a substance. Faith is a substance, which means faith is a tangible thing. It's a substance of things that are hoped for, which means it is a tangible thing, something that you can touch, of what you are hoping to do, which means that when God says it, it's something that you are hoping. It's an intent that God shows you of what he wants to do in your life, in your future, in your generation, in your locality. Therefore, faith becomes an act. Faith becomes something tangible that you do today to reach to where God has sent you. When God sends a word to Paul and Barnabas, Paul and Barnabas do not stay still. They do not stay still and rejoice over the word. The next thing that they do is that they begin to act on the word. Today, I wonder what God has told you. I wonder what God has been telling you. There are things that God has told you in the quiet moment, the day that sometimes that you are fellowshipping with him. There were times that you are fellowshipping with God and he sent a word to you. The word that he sent to you was an intent that he had to do in your life. Therefore, you got to stand up and begin acting on the word of God. Hallelujah. You've got to stand up and begin acting on the word of God. You cannot look down on yourself. You might be young, but when God says it, you stand up and begin doing what God has said. You might not have the resources, but when God says it, don't look at the circumstances that you are facing. Stand up and begin doing what God has said. But it's interesting that every time you begin to act on the word of God, you begin to act on what God has said, you begin to apply faith to the word, there are times that you will face adversities. There are times that you will begin to engage in spiritual warfare. Every time you act on the word of God, you enter into a fight. You enter into a fight. You are entering a fight not because of yourself, but you are entering a fight because of the word of God that was spoken in your life. Because there comes a time, ladies and gentlemen, that the word of God will test you. The word of God will test you. When you begin to act on the word of God, you will begin to get through tests, and you will begin to get through through fights. Today I want to just talk about fights. I'll not talk about the word of God testing you, but I will talk about the challenges, the fights that you will be facing when you begin to act on the word of God. Hallelujah. When they start acting on the word of God, the Bible says that they meet a duo. They meet a ruler. This guy had an eagerness to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. This guy even called Paul and Silas to preach to him about the gospel. But this guy had a companion. He had a friend. He had somebody that was called Bar-Jesus. And Bar-Jesus, the Bible says that withstood Paul and Barnabas so that they could not share the gospel with this ruler. The first fight that you will face, ladies and gentlemen, is against the children of the devil. Paul comes to a place that he rebukes him and he tells him that he calls him outrightly that you child of the devil. The first fight that you will face in acting on the assignment, in acting on the word of God that he has spoken against your life, will be fight against children of the devil. Hallelujah. What was the role of this man? This man had this guy under his control. This guy, but Jesus had this guy under his control. That this guy desired to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, but he was under the control of this other guy, but Jesus. This sorcerer, the first fight that you will face, ladies and gentlemen, is a fight against the demonic world, the fight against the spiritual world itself. Hallelujah. Because when the enemy wants to fight you, he sends his minions, the children of the devil, the children of darkness. There will be people who will be against the gospel. There will be people who will be against. They have held people in bondage. Therefore, they don't want them to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are nations that are locked up. There are nations that are locked up that they cannot hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not that the citizens of these nations don't want to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's just because there is a bar Jesus. There is a bar Jesus, somebody who has locked up the country that the gospel of Jesus cannot be preached. Hallelujah. The first fight that you will face is against people. People who are fighting the gospel, people who have locked up other individuals that they cannot hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. What was the response of Paul? What was the response of Paul? Paul rebuked this thing. Paul rebuked this guy, this man who was shielding this other ruler who had the desire to hear the gospel. The first thing that you got to do is that you got to engage in a spiritual warfare against the people that the enemy has under his bondage. There are people who desire to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, but somehow they don't find themselves there. Therefore, as a man that God has sent, as a man that God has sent to this generation, the first thing that you got to do is to begin to fight. To engage these things, these demonic entities that have had people bound. Because the Bible says that there are people whose eyes are blinded, that they cannot see. It's not that they don't want to see, but their eyes are blinded. The first fight that Paul faces was against such a man. The Bible says that Paul confronted him and rebuked him. Called him, you child of the devil, you son of the devil. Hallelujah. Because every time you are against the gospel of Jesus Christ, guess whom you are serving? Guess whom you are reflecting? You are reflecting the enemy. You are reflecting the enemy of souls. The enemy of souls. The enemy that will not desire for souls to be born again. Therefore, the first fight that Paul faces are the fight against the children of the devil. Hallelujah. The second fight I can call it a fight because it fights against your straying power, that power to go on at the fight against defectors. Hallelujah. When God sends these guys, he sends Paul and Barnabas. He says that, set aside for me Paul and Barnabas for the work that I have had for them. But in the process, there are people who join in the company of the people who go out. And among them was somebody who was called John Mark. John Mark was somebody that attached himself to Paul and Barnabas in going to fulfill the word that he was not given. Hallelujah. Paul and Barnabas were not given, Mark was not given this word, but John Mark goes ahead to fulfill what he has not given. Before you begin doing what you're doing, did you hear God for yourself? Did you hear God telling you what you're doing? Or are you just doing, is John Mark doing what he's doing just because he saw what Paul and Barnabas were doing? Hallelujah. John Mark attaches himself to the mission that he was not called for. I believe God had another mission for John Mark, but John Mark attached himself in a mission that he was not called to. And in the process of time, they immediately begin to face challenges. Immediately they begin to face fights. Immediately they begin to face opposition. The Bible says that John Mark withdrew from the mission. John Mark withdrew from the mission, and this thing angered Paul, and we will look at that on a later day, on a later chapter. But the second fight, ladies and gentlemen, that you will face in ministry, in your calling, in the thing that God has called you, in business, even in business, in starting business, you have agreed with somebody that you are going to start a business because you heard from God. And because this guy did not hear from God, he will begin the business with you. But when he begin to see some challenges, he will back off because he did not hear the word that you heard. Hallelujah. But then it becomes a fight for you because it demoralizes you. It brings you back from that resolve that you had in doing the work of God. The Bible says that Paul did not like this. Paul did not like this. It affected him. It affected his ministry. The second battles that you will face are against those people who are defectors. Hallelujah. In Game of Thrones, there were those people who were called defectors. And defectors, when you come back, these are people who run away from a battle. The battle is heavy. The battle is tough. And in the toughness of the battle, there are people who draw back. There are people who draw back. You start a church with 20 people. And in the process of time, you remain even 5. Because 15 were just joyriders, and you begin to build from the 5. Hallelujah. The defectors. The second thing that you will face are defectors. People who start with you but cannot stay with you. With this church, we started with people, some guys who was very enthusiastic. This ministry was started by people who are saying that how they are going, this church is going places. But along the line, these people have dropped out. Because they did not see what we were seeing. They did not see. They could not. They were not spoken to. They were not spoken to. Therefore, the second fight that you will face in the calling, in answering the call of God over your life, are defectors. The third thing that you will face are religious leaders. Hallelujah. Religion. Religion will try to bring you down in what God has called you to do. When God called you to do, they were not there. The religious leaders were not there. They were not present in the call. They were not present in the fellowship of people who were seeking God. They were not there. But when God spoke to you who were there, when you begin to do what God told you in that secret place, there are people who begin to stand against what you're doing just because you are not doing it the way it has been done before. Hallelujah. Religious leaders are people who are against change. In verse 45, the Bible says that, but when the Jews saw the multitude, these guys invite. In fact, it was an interesting scenario. Paul and Barnabas go to a synagogue, I mean. When they go into a synagogue, the leaders ask them to say something. When they begin to say something, you know, obviously these guys were filled with the gospel. If you tell them to say something, it was the gospel that was going to come out of their mouth. If you gave them a chance, it was going to be a preaching about Jesus Christ. Their message was Jesus Christ. They only had one message. If they got a chance, if they were in a court and they got a chance, their message was Jesus Christ. Therefore, in the synagogue, they're told to say something. Greet the congregation. And they stand up and they begin just to say the gospel. And in the process, they present Jesus Christ as the Messiah. And the response is great. The response is great. Therefore, in verse 45, but when the Jews saw the multitude, when they saw that the multitude, these people are responding to the gospel, they were filled with envy. The leaders were filled with envy. The Jews were filled with envy because there were people who came with a heart. Their heart were hungry to meet the Lord. But when they met the Lord, when they heard something that they had not heard before, and there is a response to the gospel of Jesus Christ, it makes the people, the Jews, hungry. It makes the leaders angry, and they become envious of Paul and Barnabas. It's important for you to know that everybody who goes to church goes because they are hungry. They go because they have something. They know there is a sense in them that tells them that there is something more to life than what we are having. They know that there is somebody more than they can relate to. There is a void in their heart that they know can be filled, but they do not know what can fill it. Therefore, they end up going to the religious places. Some are in the mosque right now because they are looking for something to fill the void that is in their heart. Some are in other churches right now, in some questionable churches right now, because they are looking for that thing that will fill the void in their heart. These people came to the synagogue because they were looking for the void that will fill their hearts. And when Paul and Barnabas saw the opportunity, they shared the gospel with them, and the multitude responded to the gospel, and they began to get born again. And this angered the religious setup. They were envy. Some of the envy that you will face in your walk with God as you begin to do what God has called you to do will be envy from religious setups. Will be envy from religious setup. They will be envious, or they will be angry about the gospel that you are preaching. They will be angry that you are not preaching what the others are preaching. You are not saying what the others are saying. You don't have that same doctrine as the others have. But because you heard a word from God, and that is what has filled you, and that is what you are saying, they become angry with you. And the gospel always produces results. The gospel of Jesus Christ, when preached, always produces results. The gospel, I say that again, the gospel of Jesus Christ, when preached, always produces results. You will see results in your life. You will see results in your ministry the moment you begin to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, these guys are hungry. They are so much angry at Paul and Barnabas. And this anger leads them to fight the message of the gospel. How does Paul and Barnabas respond to the anger and the envy of the people? They continue to preach Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Every time you face such a setup, don't stop preaching what God told you to preach. Don't change your message to please the Jews. Don't the Jews in your life. I'm not talking about the Israelis. I'm talking about the crowd that is in your life, the people who expect you to preach a certain gospel that is common in the in this generation. When you face such setup, continue preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. The response of Paul and Barnabas is that they continued to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, because the gospel of Jesus Christ has got enough power to bring somebody from hell right into heaven. Hallelujah. So don't stop preaching, and don't change your message. Don't change the message to suit or to please the crowds, to please the people who are around you. Let them be envious of you, because there is the gospel produces results. The gospel produces results. The last challenge that these people face was a challenge or a fight that was persecution. When the religious leaders saw that these guys were not stopping anytime soon, they had a resolve to continue preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ and to declare Jesus as the Messiah that was expected. These guys began to persecute the church. They began to persecute Paul and Barnabas. Therefore, the fourth thing that you will fight in when you are doing the will of God, the thing that God has told you to do, is that you will face persecution. You will face persecution. People will begin to hate you just because of what you stand for. People will begin to hate you just because of the word that you are speaking. People will begin to hate you just because of the results that you are facing. And their hatred will cause them to act on that hatred. Have you not heard that persecution in our generation right now is so high than the previous years? Why? Because it is a fight that is against the church. It's a fight that is against people who are doing what God has called them to do. The last thing that the enemy, the fight that we see Paul and Barnabas facing, was a fight against persecution. They were persecuted. And Jesus says that if they persecuted me, be sure that they will persecute you. But what is the response of Paul and Barnabas to persecution? What is the response of Paul and Barnabas against persecution? Verse 51 says that, but they shook off the dust from their feet against them, hallelujah, and came to Iconium, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit, hallelujah. The these guys are persecuted. They do not persist where they are persecuted. Jesus told them that if you go into a city and you are not accepted in that city, or you are not accepted in that home, shake the dust off your feet and move on to the next city or the next home. This is exactly what they do. When they face persecution, they don't persist where they are not wanted. They don't persist where they are not received. The Bible says that these guys shook off the dust of their feet, and they went on to another city, because the resources that you are wasting where there is a lot of persecution against you, if you apply the same resources in another place, there will be more result to what you are doing. The same message, the same people, the same anointing will have another result in another place. The Bible says that when they come into this other place, when they come to Iconium, the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. When they change location, there is a new result. There is a new reception to the what they are doing. Hallelujah. So what did I come to tell you today? I want you to know that every time God sends you a word, He expects you to act. He does not expect us just to be emotional about what he has said. He does not expect us just to be happy about what he has said. He expects us to act on what he has said. He expects us to apply faith to the word that he has said. Therefore, when you apply faith and you begin to do what God has said, you will face opposition. You will face fights. You will face fights in your life. You will face fights in your life. Not looking at what the people have been saying. In the generation that we live in, people say that when you face a fight, it's because that something, you've done something wrong. But some of the fights that you're facing is because of what you're doing in regard to what God has said. But then if you're going to get into a spiritual warfare, the first thing that Paul does is that Paul is filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't go into a spiritual warfare in the flesh. Don't go into a spiritual warfare in the flesh. First of all, you got to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You got to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You got to be filled with the Holy Spirit. As a minister, as a preacher, as a businessman, somebody who is bringing in the message of Jesus Christ, you cannot afford not to be filled by the Holy Spirit. You cannot afford not to walk in the Holy Spirit, because the moment you begin to do the work that God has called you to do, you put a huge target on your back. A gift that the enemy can shoot that target. What will shield you is when you are walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Let's pray as we finish today. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your people. I thank you, Lord, because of the word that you have spoken in their lives. There are some people that you have given specific instructions about doing certain things. You have set them apart for a particular thing. And Lord, they have not been doing what you have told them. I pray that you will give them the boldness to act upon what you have said. Give them the boldness to act upon your word, O God, in the name of Jesus. There are some that are acting on the word, and there are challenges, there are fights that they are facing. I pray that Jesus Christ, that you will give them the grace. You will give them the grace to go through what they are going through with boldness, O God, knowing that, Lord, they are facing this thing and you are right in the middle of it with them, Lord. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord. I magnify your name. Lord, I pray for those who are looking for you, but there are some forces of darkness that have shielded them, that they cannot be reached. Lord, I pray that let those things be broken in the name of Jesus. I command everything that the enemy has sent against the people, that their eyes should be blind to see what God is doing. I pray that let those things be broken in the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you. I give you praise. I give you glory, for it's in Jesus' name we pray and believe. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. I want to just tell you by way of announcement that our anniversary is coming on the 11th. We moved it from the 4th to the 11th because of some reasons. And we will be having a very, very, very powerful week that week. And from the Thursday and Friday, Saturday and Sunday, we'll be having online services, online sessions right here at Leicester Church, and I want you to be part of it. I want you to just be here, because I believe that this is going to be an appointment that God has with somebody. This is going to be a time of an appointment. As we turn three, God will turn you into another year, into another season in your life. I want you to come in, and we'll be having Reverend Chris Atemo coming right here on a Sunday morning in person. We'll be having an on-location service, an online service, both services right here at Leicester Church. I want you to be part of it. I want you to come in and let's celebrate the Lord together. Let's celebrate our third year anniversary together. You are welcome, and may God bless you. Remember that on Sunday we are here again. We'll be here on location. If you live around Umoja, We welcome you to be part of what God is doing. Just come in and see what God is doing here, and see what you can do in this place. And if you live, if you don't live around Umoja, then we'll be online. You can join us at around 7:30 before you go to your service. You can join us and just hear a quick word, maybe have a snack before you go for the other meal in the place that you go to on a Sunday morning. And I want you to have a good weekend, and my prayer is that the Lord God will bless you and that you will begin to do what God has told you to do. Hallelujah. Great weekend. Bye-bye.